Hi, and welcome to my video on multiple regression analysis. In order to understand what multiple regression analysis is, we need to first understand what regression is. So regression is basically a statistical tool that involves a dependent variable and an independent variable, or in some cases multiple independent variables and a dependent variable, and we try to find out the relationship between them. To be more specific, with regard to multiple regression analysis, we have multiple independent variables that can help us predict the dependent variable. Yeah. So let me simplify this with an example. Here, let's assume that I'm a farmer and I grow wheat. Yeah. And we have four independent factors here, or four independent variables here, which is the sunlight, pesticides, fertility of the soil, and rainfall. Now I'm a farmer and I'm interested in finding out how much agricultural output I will be getting this year. Now, to identify to predict the output, I need to perform the regression test. That's what it is. And let's say that sunlight is one factor, one independent factor. Can I say that the amount of based on the amount of sunlight that we've had this year, I will be getting a certain amount of output? Or can I say that the quality of the pesticides that I've been using will determine how much output I will get? Or can I say that the fertility of the soil will play a role in helping me predict the agricultural output this year? Or will it be the rainfall, the quality, the amount of rainfall that we've had will help me predict the output this year? Yeah. So I want to know the best significant predictor of my agricultural output. Can I look at the sun and say it? Or can I look at the amount of pesticides I've used and say that? And should I look at the fertility of the soil and say that? Or should I look at the amount of rainfall we've had and to determine the agricultural output that I'm going to get? So it's a game of prediction, and I will use one of these factors to identify how much agricultural output I'm going to get. Or in some cases, as in the case of multiple regression analysis, we may have all four factors contributing together to the agricultural output, but one being more powerful than the other. Yeah, and that's what multiple regression analysis is. It's a game of prediction in some sense. And in the next part of the video, we are going to be using a data file to explain how this actually works. Yeah. So welcome back to the video. Now we opened up a data file. This is on cancer patients and their mental health. So there are only 40 respondents here. Ideally, tests like regression would be better off if there were more respondents. However, we only have 40, and for the example's sake, we are going to be using this data file. This study was about the mental health of cancer patients, as I said, with special focus on depression, anxiety, and stress. So we are going to be only considering depression as a dependent variable, and we are going to be taking two independent variables, which is age and time since diagnosis. Yeah, that is time since the respondent was diagnosed with cancer. So you must always have some hypothesis when you performing a test. Like for regression, my hypothesis is that age and time since diagnosis could play a role in predicting the depression score of the respondents. So that's my hypothesis, that's my assumption. So age and time since diagnosis will be my independent variables. Now there are several criterions, or rather there are several rules that we need to obey before performing the regression test. Yeah. The first one is that the data should be normally distributed, not the data itself, but the residues of the regression, which I'll be talking about later. The other important assumption, the other important condition is that there should not be any multicollinearity. Multicollinearity basically means it's a situation when the independent variables in your study are actually correlated with each other at a strong level. If there is a very strong correlation between the independent variables, then it's difficult for us to perform the regression analysis. Regression analysis generally should not be performed, because it becomes difficult to predict how much influence each of the independent variable actually has on the dependent variable, because they're so close to each other. We can't say that which one is having more influence on the dependent variable. So we generally try to avoid performing regression when we have multicollinearity. So how do we test multicollinearity? For testing that, we need to go to analyze. We need to go to bivariate correlation. And then we need to include two variables, which I've already included here. I'll just show you again. One is age, yeah, which is in continuous form. Always remember the independent variables should be in continuous form in linear regression. So age, and the other variable that we're going to be putting in is time since diagnosis of cancer. So that's the second variable. So these two are my independent variables. I want to make sure that they are not strongly correlated with one another. If they're strongly correlated with one another, then I would not be performing the regression analysis. So let's go and check it out. So I click OK. And here we have it, the correlation results. So as you can see, age and time since diagnosis have a correlation of 0.28. Yeah, so that's the correlation. It's 0.28. There are several studies showing the acceptable levels with regard to multicollinearity, but there's one study that shows that anything that's close to 7.7 or above is a sign of multicollinearity. That means they are too strongly correlated, the independent variables, and that we must not perform the regression analysis. And so I'll be putting the link of that study in the description if I find it. And but that's the general rule. But some others would argue that it's 0.5. We can't take anything more than 0.5. Some would say 7. But 0.2 definitely is not a very strong correlation. So therefore, we can go ahead and perform the regression analysis. In the next part of the video, we'll talk about the next condition for performing the regression analysis, which is the normality of the residuals. Okay. Now that we have checked for multicollinearity and we have found that there is no multicollinearity between the independent variables, we are going to perform the next test to find out whether we can actually perform the regression analysis. The second condition, as I said, was with regard to the normality of the residuals. Now it's not normality of the data, but the normality of the residuals. Based on that, we can say whether we can actually perform the regression analysis or not. There are several other conditions of multiple regression analysis or linear regression. I'm not going to go into that. It's a separate topic altogether. But these are the two most important things, which is multicollinearity and normality of the data. Now, for checking the normality of the residuals, we need to first get the residuals. Yeah, how do we get the residuals? We go to analyze, yeah, and then we go to regression, and then we select linear, yeah, because we're performing linear regression. And we are going to select our dependent variable first, which is depression, total score of depression. Then we are going to select the independent variables, which is age, that's one, and the other one was time since diagnosis. Yeah, these are the two. Now there's one option here called save. Click on save and select predicted values and residuals, most important residuals. So click on predicted values and residuals and click continue. Now click on OK. You can open the output. Okay, so now we have the output here. We have created the residuals. So you can see the residuals actually in the data file itself. Just scroll to the last part of this data file. And here, can you see the residuals? Yeah. So what are the residuals actually? Yeah. So we'll have an idea of what the residuals are if you look at the dependent variable. So I'll just try and copy paste the dependent variable if it's possible. Otherwise, we'll just have a look at it from there. Total depression. Yeah, here it is. I don't think I can copy it, but I'll just try. Yeah. Okay, so we can't copy it. So there's a problem with the thing. Otherwise, yeah, if you just look at the predicted values here. Yeah, now I think you can get a clear idea. So this is the residuals. Yeah, so this is what we actually predicted based on the age of the respondent and their time since diagnosis. We predicted that their score would actually be 14.81, but the score actually turned out to be 4. Yeah, and then in the second case, we predicted the value to be 14.48, but it came out to be 18. So that's pretty close. So that's why the residuals is 3.52. Okay, when you minus 18 minus 14.48, you'll get this value. Similarly, so that's how it is. So basically, we are trying to predict the dependent variable, which is the total depression score, based on the age of the respondent and time since diagnosis. This is what we have predicted. This is what the regression test has predicted. And these are the residuals, you know, the errors, the gap, in other words. So we need to find out whether these residuals is normally distributed. Only if the residuals are normally distributed can we go ahead and perform the regression test. So let's go and test the normality of this residuals. For testing the normality, we go to graphs, click on histogram, yeah, and then select the residuals, which will be at the very bottom. This RES1, that's the residuals, pull it in into the variables. Now there's an important option to click here called the display normal curve. This is a normality curve. We want to see if the data is normally distributed. So we click the normality curve, display normal curve, and then click OK. Now we go to the output and we'll find a graph over there. Yeah, so this is the histogram. So this is a normality curve. Ideally, all of the values should be inside it, and the one in the center should be the biggest. So this is actually not a perfect normal curve, but can we still use it? That's the question. Can we still perform the regression analysis? You know, normality is a very, vague concept, because sometimes, you know, the data is not always perfect. So because the topic is such, so in some cases we won't have perfect normal data. So what do we do? In this case, it looks normal, but not perfectly normal. Okay. So what do we do here? We perform another test. Okay, that can be performed in SPSS actually, and we get this result called the Shapiro-Wilk test of normality. Yeah, you can do this in SPSS or any other statistical tool that you may have, and this basically tells us whether we can go ahead with the regression analysis. It tells us whether the data is normally distributed or not. If the data is normally distributed, you will not have a significance. Yeah, so if it's normally distributed, it should be greater than zero. The significance should be greater than 0.05. yeah, so in this case it's much greater, so that means the data is normally distributed and that we can go ahead with the regression analysis. Yeah, note here is that in case you do get a normally distributed data, in case this curve is perfect and all the values are inside the curve as expected, you need not perform the Shapiro-Wilk test. You can just look at the curve and decide for yourself whether the data is normally distributed and go ahead with the regression test. Yeah, so that's something to remember. So now that we have satisfied the two major conditions for performing the linear regression analysis or the multiple regression analysis, we can now actually perform the regression analysis. So what have we satisfied? The two conditions. Number one is with regard to multicollinearity. Multicollinearity is when the independent variables are strongly correlated with one another, but we have proven that they are not strongly correlated. So there is no multicollinearity in our data. The second important thing is that the residuals are normally distributed. They're not perfectly normally distributed, but the Shapiro-Wilk test shows that they're not too far away from the normal distribution. So it's safe enough for us to perform the regression analysis. Now that both the conditions have been satisfied with regard to the normality and the multicollinearity, there are some other conditions as well for performing this regression analysis, but I won't go into it. As I said, these are the two major things that we need to take note of. Now we'll actually perform the regression analysis. Go to Analyze, select Regression. It's the same thing we did last time. Select Regression, click on Linear. Now the variables are already in, so I'll just pull them back out to show you. First, we select the dependent variable, which is the total depression. Then we select the age, okay? And then we select the time since diagnosis, which is the other independent variable. So we have two independent variables, age and time since diagnosis. It's important to note that it would be ideal if both of these variables are in continuous form rather than categorical or otherwise. Then we have the dependent variable, which is the depression score. Then we click on statistics. Make sure everything is clicked here. Yeah, R, ANOVA and all of that. Click continue. Then we click on OK. Now we go to the output file. Yeah, actually I've done it twice. When you look at the table over here, the bottom over here, they're both the same actually. You can look at the R-square. Yeah, the R-square essentially tells us the exact amount of influence age and time since diagnosis have on the depression score. Yeah, so that's what the R-square actually says. And if you look at the regression value, it's this is the value, the regression value, it's 2706, and the residual value is about 2400 and odd. It's always important to note that the regression value should always be greater than the residual value. So if you've done a successful regression test, if regression is actually worth it, the regression should be greater than the residuals. And in this case, it's slightly more, and so it is acceptable. Yeah. And as I said, together they contribute about 0.52, that's about 52%. So 52% of the influence on the depression score can be explained by age of the respondent and the time since diagnosis of the respondent with regard to cancer. The other 48%, however, remains unexplained. So there may be other variables that may be influencing or predicting the depression score, but we don't know. But as far as our regression test is concerned, these two predictors, that is age and time since diagnosis, predict the depression score of the respondents. And they predict about 52% of the score of the respondents with regard to depression. Yeah. Now, we will try to explain the exact influence each of the two variables have. So, age and time since diagnosis. For that, we need to look at this table, the coefficients table. In the coefficients table, there are two important things that we need to note. One is the unstandardized beta weight. The unstandardized beta weight is the capital B over here. And the standardized beta weight over here, you can see it's called beta. We are more interested in the unstandardized beta weight. What is the unstandardized beta weight? Well, unstandardized beta weight is essentially based on actual points, while the standardized beta weight is based on standard deviations. So standardized beta weights are useful when you talk, when you have, different, basically different values to compare to and all of that. So we won't go into that. We'll only explain the unstandardized beta weight. So when you look at the unstandardized beta weight, you can see that age, you can see the value here, it's minus 0.59, which essentially means that when age goes up by one unit, so age is measured in years. So when age goes up by one unit, the unstandardized, the depression score of the respondent goes down by 0.59 units. Why do I say it goes down? Because you have minus here. So it's minus 0.59, which means that when the age goes up by one unit, the depression score of the respondent goes down. It decreases by 0.59 units. Then similarly, we look at time since diagnosis. When the time since diagnosis of the respondent goes up by one unit, the dependent variable, that is the depression score of the respondent, goes down by 0.44 units. Why do we say 0.44 units? Because it's here and you can see the minus symbol, so it goes down. So which basically means that as the respondents grow older, I mean, the older the respondent, the lesser the depression score, and the longer the time since diagnosis, the lesser the depression score. Yeah, so older respondents and those people who've been diagnosed for longer periods of time are less depressed compared to young respondents who have been recently diagnosed with cancer. It makes sense. So that's what it is. In the next part of the video, I'll be explaining, I'll be putting all of this in a small table and explaining it. The other thing to note here is the significance value. So if you look at the significance value, age, it's perfectly, there's a statistically significant relationship at a very high level. And with regard to time since diagnosis, the significance value is 0.028, which is less than 0.05. So both are significant predictors of depression. Yeah. So that's what we found out here. And as I said, in the next part of the video, I'll be explaining how to put all of this in a table and explain it. Okay, so now we're going to explain this in the form of a table, a single table. So I've copied some of the important results that we found in the regression analysis in the output file, and I've put it in a simple table. So the results of the multiple regression analysis can be seen in table 1. Based on the results, it can be said that age and time since diagnosis together predict or explain 52%, that is C column 3. So you can see this 0.52, that's 52% of the variance in the dependent variable, that is depression score of the cancer patients. So age and time since diagnosis together have about 52% influence, or they predict 52% of the dependent variable, that is depression. Moreover, when age of the respondent goes up by one unit, the depression score of the respondent goes down by 0.59 units, C column 2. So you can see here, it's minus 0.59. So on the other hand, when time since diagnosis of the respondent goes up by one unit, the depression score of the respondent also goes down by 0.44 units. So there is a negative relationship. Both of these independent variables have a negative relationship with depression. This means that the older the respondents are and the longer it has been since they were diagnosed with cancer, the lesser the depression score and vice versa. Yeah. However, it must be noted that the 48% of the variance remains unexplained. So when you minus this 52 from 100, you get 48. So 48% of the variance is unexplained, which means that there could be other variables that could play a role in significantly predicting the depression score of the respondents. However, these two variables together predict about 52% of the dependent variable. So that's about it for multiple regression analysis. I know it's a long video and there are a lot of concepts in them. In case you have any doubts, you can put them in the comment section. And like and subscribe my channel for more such videos. Thanks and have a nice day.